Hi, this is Siofra Bradigan, and this is Siofra's Magic Alcove. So, before I jump into the meat of the video, wanted to give you all a quick update on what's been going on around here. I had a rather odd week, I have to say. I got contacted by a local woman who's in her early 80s about her son who's in his 50s and asked if I could meet with him because something was going on at his house. And so with COVID happening, I don't feel that comfortable just going into someone else's house, especially for paranormal investigation, because you never know what you're going to find. So I arranged to meet him at his mother's place outside on her porch. So, you know, we were keeping our distance, etc. And I have to say it was an incredibly unusual encounter. As soon as he walked in the door, I could see something attached to his back. I mean, in my point of view, it was a larva. Those are things that are sort of created sometimes by obsessive thinking or by addictive behavior or being addicted to a physical substance. And as he started to talk about what was going on, it evolved into he thinks there's a alien refinery under his house. He put holes in his walls trying to find the cameras that were watching him. I mean, it just was a lot of stuff. And he kept describing these creatures, which he thought were aliens, in vivid detail. And I saw each time he described them, they got more distinct. So it was like his description and his attention to them was feeding their reality or their existence or what have you. And I took a tact that, from what he said, that they were trying to change his body and his body chemistry in order to be more compatible with them, and he clearly didn't like this, to do things to try and change his body chemistry more to match the Earth, the planetary energy, which was apparently toxic to them, in order to get them away from him and off of him. He also was convinced that he was telekinetic and gave us a demonstration of that, said he lifted up a house across the street, and of course we didn't see anything happening. Not that I think he's lying about that. I think that he is seeing it, but not in the physical reality. I think he's seeing it on another plane, and that's what I told him. So I worked with him as well as I could under the circumstances, because this is definitely not my area of expertise, and it was pretty clear he wouldn't believe anything I said about larva or energies and all this other stuff. I did find out that whatever that thing was on his back did not like black tourmaline, so I recommended he get some to make himself like less palatable to whatever these things are. And then I referred him to another group that I know of that has experience dealing with this level of, I'm not sure what to call it. Anyway, it was an odd thing I didn't expect. I usually get called in for ghosts and hauntings and things like that, but this was a different level of, I'm not sure what to call it, infestations of some kind. But it was an interesting experience to see how the interpretation of what we have happened to us can really color our, what we define it as later, our understanding of it. It really depends upon the viewpoint we choose to take. Now, if he had taken the kind of viewpoint I would take, which would be he was creating some kind of a larval entity thing on himself and becoming healthier mentally and emotionally and physically would help to get rid of it, then I could probably have worked with him. So I had a couple of days where I was feeling a little bit anxious, making sure I didn't get anything attached to me. And I was fine, so that's always good. But it just sort of shows the real total range of potential narratives that we tell ourselves or that we think are true. And it's always a good idea to be able to take a step back from whatever our narrative is. And have a look at it and try and determine whether it makes sense or not, and if it works for us, or if it's some kind of a thing we're just adopting in order to feel special or different, or I don't know, a victim or whatever. I mean, there's any number of possibilities there. So I just thought I'd bring you up to date. So we decided today we're going to talk about building your own astral temple. And I was first introduced to the notion of an astral temple by Dion Fortune's books. I'm pretty sure that was the first place I came across them. That was probably in the late 70s, somewhere around there, I think. Mid-70s, maybe. Because I think I was living in Regina, Saskatchewan at that point, when I was reading some of her books. And my daughter was born in 75, so that would have been around that time. And I was fascinated by the idea. I mean, they just sort of gave me the kernel of the idea, and I immediately decided to build one, because why not, right? I don't have to have any money or building materials in order to make an astral temple. The idea of they call it an astral temple, and whether it is in the astral plane, the mental plane, or a combination of both is up to interpretation. And the idea of it is to build yourself a sanctuary, a magical environment that you are in charge of, that you can control, and that becomes kind of your safe harbor, your anchor for doing other magical works. So if you wanted to do an out-of-body experience and you were feeling a little bit anxious about what might happen, you would go to your astral temple first, and then from there you would go and do your astral travel and see what came around. And then if something made you anxious or nervous or whatever, you could zip back to your astral temple and nothing could get in and interfere with you, because it's your environment. You totally create it on your own. So the thing about making your own astral temple that's fun and interesting and fascinating is that it can be absolutely anything you can imagine. So if you are into Greek or Egyptian, Roman temples and stuff like that, and you have an idea in your head that you want to have a bunch of pillars and, you want gold all over the floor, whatever you can visualize, you can have. And in the beginning, that's how you do it. You sort of decide what you want to create. I think my first one I made had all these marble steps going up to some awesome, pillars, and then inside this like incredible building that I had made up in my mind. And as you use it and continue to go there, it'll actually start to change depending on you, like what you've learned, where you're at. It shows you some of your progress, and it will actually show it to you before you even know that it's happened. So that makes it kind of interesting. So I was thinking about this for people, like I have a vivid imagination, and I don't have a problem with like in my head constructing something and visualizing it and stuff like that. But not everyone can do that. Or, for some people it's a struggle to visualize something in their head. So I was thinking that something that people could do who had difficulty with that would be to find pictures in like magazines or online or whatever, something that they really liked a lot, and print up a picture, and they could create their own temple that way, like starting as a collage or an art project or something of that nature, and that would also build it on the other planes. And then as you progress and you get better at visualizing, imagining, or what have you, it would be there for you, or you could just still use the pictures, whatever works. So for me, I hadn't visited my astral temple in a long time, and my husband and I took a course from a witch up the coast from us, and one of the assignments was to build your astral temple, or in my case, visit your astral temple and see what was there. And I found that process quite interesting, because it had been so long since I'd traveled into it, and how much had changed. And since we have our physical temple here, I use this as like my ground for building the astral temple. And so what I did was I sat here in our temple and then sort of vibrated myself up into the astral plane and then started looking around in the different directions to see what there was. And I was quite fascinated by what I found. It was a very different place than the first one I ever made, so it's kind of cool. And that's when I discovered for me the different animals that are associated with the elements. Not everyone's going to have the same associations, obviously, but it was pretty interesting. So the first direction that I looked at, of course, was the east, because that's where I usually see, and that's where I start my circle most of the time, is in the east. And for me, the east was there, it was like a lot of glass, kind of solidified air, I guess, that was in it. And it started off as a cave on this side, and I actually traveled into the air kingdom to see what was out there from the temple, which is another experiment that you can do. And when I got into the cave, I found a winged griffin who was there, who was apparently my animal for air, and I got on his back and I flew through the air to this clear palace. It was like all made out of glass or clear or whatever. It was very ornate looking, except you could see through it. And I got off the griffin and I was walking up the steps, and I started to worry, like when I go into this building and if you can see through everything but there's still walls, I could get lost and how am I going to find my way out? And I looked down and saw that everywhere I took a step, I was leaving these little blue flowers. I thought, well, that was brilliant. So I'm leaving my own little breadcrumbs, little blue flowers, wherever I walk. So I went all the way in and came into a throne room, I guess you would say. There was this being who was sitting on this glass throne, and I sort of communed with this spirit for a while, and mostly just kind of like, googly all around. It's like, wow, this is pretty cool. I was pretty excited. And so then I made my way back and came back into my temple and then my physical temple. So the next element I looked at was the fire element, and I was really surprised to see this green phoenix. It was just bam, it was right there. It was like there's this big fiery green flames, not red flames, just green flames. And I looked at it and I thought, okay, well, the phoenix makes sense because that's sort of a creature of fire and mythology and so forth, but why green? And then I remembered, oh yeah, green is the opposite of red, and so if the phoenix is actually my doorway into the fire element, then it'd be easy to find my way back out. So I was like, okay, cool. So I walked through, and I didn't get very far with the fire element because I'm still kind of about it. Remembering getting burned at the stake kind of makes me anxious. But, you know, I went in a little bit and then came back out as an experiment just to see what was going on. And then when I went into the west and the water, first there was a fountain. You know, it was just like, well, not a fountain so much as like a bird bath almost. It was like a big round thing of water. And when I decided I wanted to go into it, it turned into a pool that went down. And I looked down and I saw that it was an entrance into the water kingdom. And I went down into that because air and water are easier elements for me, so they were the simpler ones to do. And I went swimming all the way down into the bottom and met some of the, I guess, merpeople or water spirits, whatever terminology you want to use to call them, and was down there for quite a while. Some dolphins came in and out, and then when I was ready to go back, I looked up and there was this tiny little white light circle in the top, and I realized that was the pool I'd come down. So I went back up that way. But before I went in, the animal that I saw in the west was actually the peacock, which surprised me because I was just like, well, okay, I thought like a swan or, you know, a heron, some kind of a water bird, but no, it's a peacock. It was very showy, a male peacock. It went whoop with his feathers and danced around a little bit. And I'm like, Yeah, that's definitely a peacock. So that was sort of fascinating to me to figure out some of my own internal associations with the elements. And I think it's the shape of the eyes are sort of like scales, the colors are water-like. And then I did some research and discovered that in a number of cultures around the world, the peacock is associated directly with the water element. And then, of course, I have that personal connection with the peacock, with Argus and his eyes and everything being in the tail of the peacock, and I've always been drawn to them. So it was an interesting look into my brain, I guess. And then when I went into I looked at the north, and there was this big giant tree in the north, and it was big enough to walk into. There was like a path that went into the tree, and I went up into the tree, and there were two paths, one that went up and one that went down, and I was really attracted to the one that went down. I wanted to go down there and see what I could find. And so I started walking down the route, down into the underground, and then my panther, who's one of my spirit animals, suddenly blocked my path. It was very clear. It was just like, bam, stop. I went like, okay, so I came back up and didn't go in there. So I'm still experimenting with that. It's not something I do all the time, but it's there. The most fascinating thing I found in my temple was in the center of it. There was a circle of sand. Now, and the sand that was in there was a special sand from my childhood. When I was, I think I was, in third or fourth grade, maybe, somewhere around there. And we lived on base in Rhode Island, and I would go out in the woods all the time. I mean, that was kind of like my thing to do, get away from the house. Anything to do to get away from the house, go to school, go outside, anything away from the house, because being home was way too dangerous. And I was wandering through the woods one day, and I came across this sand in the middle of a trail. It was like there wasn't any sand anywhere else. It was just this one spot. And I got down and I felt it, and it was like the softest sand I've ever felt. It was kind of like talcum powder. And I would go back there numerous times, and I would sit in this little patch. It was only about 3 feet across, maybe, and as wide as the path was. And I would just sit there and play in that sand for hours and stuff. So it was pretty interesting to see that in my temple. And I looked at it and I thought, what could I, you know, for one, why is it there? Okay, so I think I figured that out because it was such a unique experience. But then what could I do with it? And I realized that I can draw sigils or whatever, pictures in the sand to work with it inside my temple. And then I can, you know, go like that and make them all go away. So I was pretty excited. So it's like the idea of building an astral temple. It doesn't have to be a building, for one. It can be an outdoor place. I have outdoor spaces in that environment, too, because I could see them where I had trees and that kind of thing. And it's a good neutral location for meeting spirit guides or other entities that you're working with. It helps to teach you about trance work, because in order to actually get there completely, you have to be able to put yourself into that deep meditative state and really get into the visualization that you're creating. When I work with the guys up in the prison, so one of the things we work on is creating an astral temple and then creating the magical tools that they can't have. And so this is a good technique for anyone who is on a serious budget, living at home. No one will let you have an altar or a space or a sacred space. You can build your own sacred space in that environment and make it as elaborate or as simple as you want. And then no one can take it away from you or touch your stuff. And you can learn about using the different tools like wands and athames and cups. And, you know, you can create their astral forms and mental forms in the astral temple, and you can do, when you get good at it, elaborate rituals only in that place. So it can become a really good teaching and learning environment, And then when you get to a better place where you're like not at home, or you're with someone who isn't judgmental about your chosen path and doesn't freak out that you want to have an altar, or you have enough money to buy the things that you want, or you can find the things that you want at secondhand stores and whatnot, or someone might give you things. Sometimes what will happen is the things that you've been using and visualizing in your astral temple will actually come to you as physical objects, and then you're sort of manifesting them as you go. And doing that kind of work on the different planes for a lot of things is valuable and important. When I started practicing casting the circle around my room every night, I would cast it using the invoking pentagrams physically one night. Another night I would do it astrally, and another night I would do it mentally. And so I was building up this energy of and solidifying my circle and my protection on all three planes as I was doing it that way. And a funny thing happened one night when I was doing it astrally. I fell asleep partway through. I got the air, I got the fire, I started the water, and then I was sound asleep. And I don't know, 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, all of a sudden it was like this sensation of cold water being thrown on my face. I mean, it just was like splash like that. And it woke me up out of a sound sleep. And I'm like, what the? I'm like, oh, I forgot to finish my circle. So then I started on the west, you know, the water, and then kept on going around. And so that was kind of humorous that it was so solidified in my mental landscape that I had to finish it even if I had fallen asleep. So I thought that was pretty special. So anyway, it's a simple and complex thing, like everything that we do. Like the more you try it, the more you practice it, the better at it you become. And you can create like triggers to get there if you need to. I mean, as you're doing this in the beginning, you have to work at getting yourself in a centered place and getting where you need to be and visualize it. But like with all these different exercises, you can create shortcuts. And so the more often you do it, the shortcut you create will become a faster shortcut for when you need it. Like if you're in, I'm not sure exactly what sort of emergency situation would require you to be able to jump into your astral temple, but you never know. And so you can create like a word that is associated with it, or a gesture, like with any of these things. So it's like up to you as far as what you do. And then as you continue with your studies and you progress along the path that you've chosen, you'll find that your astral temple will change its look as you continue. And so you can actually witness your own mind, as it were, changing in your perceptions of reality and what works and what's happening and stuff like that as you continue on along. So, anyway, so that's probably good enough for this, because I was thinking of doing a guided meditation for it, but we'll have to do that in another video instead of the long explanation kind of a thing. And we still have so many subjects to discuss. So I hope that this finds you all well, and that you're taking care of yourselves, and that you're staying safe and having fun wherever you are on the planet. And so this is Siofra Bradigan, and this has been Siofra's Magic Alcove. Blessed be.